Hey Pixelers, welcome back. Now let's go for our final major task. We're going to put this into a cluster and actually have some cool resources to start playing around with. First things first, I'm going to need you to buy two more Hetzner machines and do everything again, all over again for those two new machines. The main difference is you have to make sure you give them their own networking configurations here. Also, in the DHCP configuration, you want to give them slightly different ranges. And the reason is because we're not creating a central DHCP server for everything to connect to. So in order to keep things in sync and in the right ranges, we're just going to give them slightly different ranges to each other. Then, once you've done that, let's come over to Hetzner Robot. And then what we want to do is we want to create two vswitches. The first one is going to be for our nodes. So all of our nodes, our physical nodes, the machines we've purchased from Hetzner, can talk to each other as if they were on the same private network, all with a different 192.168 IP address range. And this is essential for putting them into a cluster. Then we want to create another vswitch for our virtual machines. So even though our virtual machines are on different Hetzner hosts, they can still talk to each other as if they were on the same host with the same 192.168.192 range we created before for our VMBR2 machines. So let's create two vswitches. I've already done it. And you should have something that looks like what I have down here. One with a VLAN of 4000 and one with a VLAN of 4001. VLAN is a virtual LAN. So it was a virtualization of a real LAN. Then once you've done that, you want to come down here and you want to add your various servers. So I'm going to do that right now for both of them. And this takes about a minute to actually apply. Then, once they're all done, you'll see them all listed green because they've been successfully configured and put on the vswitch. And the cool thing is when you come over to Hetzner Robot again, you'll be able to see which machines are on a vswitch because it'll say so here. Now, let's go onto all of these machines and we want to go to the firewall and we want to add new rules. This IPv6 packet filtering should have been enabled from before. However, we're going to add two rules now. The first one, I'm going to put PVE nodes, which I consider to be the host machines, and we're going to allow connectivity for an IP range that we're going to give to our nodes. In this example, I'm going to use a 192.168.50 range with a 24 side block. Obviously, we want to now accept that traffic and do the same thing for the IP range we gave VMBR2 in our virtual machines. So that is 192.168.192/0 in the 18 block, and make sure both of these are accepted and now apply. Do this for all of your servers, not just this one, so they can all communicate without any firewalls blocking them. Now let's set up our networking configuration again by going into our network interfaces file. The reason why I didn't create a VMBR1 before is that's going to be the name of our interface for our nodes. You'll see here that I'm defining a IP address here, specifically .11. This is going to be the IP address of this node. So when you apply this configuration to all of the other nodes, which you need to do, you'll want to make it, for example, .12, .13, .14, whatever you prefer. So I like to keep it kind of obvious which node is which. So I'm using .11 for my first node. I know it sounds weird to you, but to me it sounds logical. And also, because it's in the 24 block, that means that I can have up to 255 nodes within this subnet group. Now we want to add our interface here, like we did before. So ENP7SO is my interface. And we're doing .4000. We're being very explicit in telling our operating system that this needs to be sent over the VLAN, which is our vswitch. Down here, it's very important you need to set the MTU. The MTU is the maximum size of the packet, and it's very important you set this because Hetzner has a limit with their vswitches. You also want to come down here to VMBR2, because we're also going to put this on the vswitch, and you want to now specify the MTU here too. And because we're going to put this on the vswitch, we also want to come down here and put our interface into the bridge ports for 4001, because that's going to be the virtual LAN that our VMs are going to communicate with each other on. Awesome, now we've configured it correctly, we can save this file and exit. Remember to do an IF reload so these changes are actually taken place. So now we've given our node a private IP range, we need to update our hosts file to represent this information. So let's change the IP address up here to my new private IP address. Remember that I was explicit in my configuration of using .11, so we represent that same IP address here. For each node, you'll give a different IP address here, just like you'll give a different IP address in the network configuration. So for my other nodes, it's .11, .12, and .13. You can do it however you want, though. Remember, make sure to do the changes we just did to the other nodes as well. It's very important that it's all nicely updated for our new fancy cluster setup. Now, all we have to do is go to our cluster and press Create Cluster. Now, this is very important. Reload your interface right now so Proxmox picks up the new private IP address rather than the previous public IP address when it's telling the other node who to connect to. Let's give it a cluster name such as main or whatever you fancy. And once it's done, you'll see the message task complete. In the spirit of my other video, I highly recommend you implement firewall rules with IP tables to limit the traffic between your various nodes. As you can see here, these are the various ports that Proxmox uses. However, I'm going to gloss over that in this video. Now we've created our cluster, now we just have to press join information. And you should see here for IP address, it will give us our local IP address. All you have to do is come down here and click copy information. Now, all we have to do is go to our other nodes, go to data center cluster, and just go to join cluster. Paste in the information there, put in the root password of the original Proxmox machine. And for the link here, you want to put down VMBR1's interface. So they're all going to communicate to each other with the same subnet. And once we press connect, it's going to log in and try to join the node. And as you can see here, we're now seeing that it went from gray to green. So this implies everything was going good. Now, all we have to do is repeat the same exercise for the last node. I believe the join information is unique per node. So you need to recopy it for each node you wish to add. And once again, we set the link specific for this node. Then we go back to our first node and we should see it go from red to gray to green, which is perfect. Exactly what we're looking for. Awesome. Now we have a whole entire cluster for our virtual machines. And if we wanted to, we could run multiple virtual machines on different Proxmox hosts and they can communicate to each other. Let's do that. I'm going to create another Fedora node. I'm going to call this one network test. Use the Fedora image. Make sure we put it on a VMBR2. We don't want to specify the VLAN, even though it asks us because we're being very explicit in our configuration. Let's make sure the Fedora VM we started last time is also coming up. And now if I do ifconfig in each one, on my first node, it's a 201.0 address. And in my second one, I fully expect to see a 202.0 IP address because it has a different DHCP configuration, which is exactly what I see. However, let's see if this 192.168.202 can communicate to the 201 machine. And we are receiving ping responses here. So this machine is now communicating with the PVE virtual machine here. Perfect. So we've basically created a virtual LAN mesh across all of the machines we create. This is amazing. Now, as a small bonus, I figured I'd show you very quickly how we can set up Ceph. So first things first, we have to install Ceph on each node. So if we go to data center, we can go to Ceph here, and it will tell us that we do not have Ceph installed on our nodes. So we can press install Ceph. Then we can come down here and I'm just going to set it to the Reef version and set my repository to no subscription. It's now going to ask to confirm whether or not I want to install the various libraries that Ceph needs. So let's press yes. We have to repeat this for every single node individually. So we go to each node and go to its Ceph page and follow this installation wizard. Once you get down to here, you'll see the next button is ready to be pressed. And we can come over here. And for the public network IP and for the cluster one, I like to just set it to the VMBR1 network, just to make things simple for now. Make sure to repeat this for every single node. So first things first, let's come over to OSD and create a new OSD. This is an object store daemon. So press create and select the disks you want to add into your Ceph cluster. I have two examples here. One is an NVMe drive and one is a hard drive, if you remember from right at the beginning. So I'm going to add both of these. You want to repeat this exercise for every single node again, so all of them have been added into Ceph. Now, once everything's been added, you can press this reload button to download the latest configuration. It doesn't seem to update itself automatically, so press reload and you should see all of your different hosts here and the different drives attached. You'll also see the different classes for the different devices. So we have one here with the class of SSD and one with the class of HDD. So we want to make sure these are going to be in different Ceph clusters, or otherwise, like I said, it will degrade to the slowest device in that cluster. So in order to do that, we need to create a custom crush rule, and you have to do this in the CLI. So I'm on PVE1, you only have to do this on one node, and I'm creating a new crush rule called replicated hard drive, HDD, and we're looking for all devices which are of the device class of HDD. We're going to run this and we're going to repeat it again for SSD, just like this. Now, if we go back to Proxmox, we can create new pools for our new crush rules. So I'm going to create my first rule called block HDD, because this is going to be the block drive. And I'm going to go over to advanced, and I'm going to select my new crush rule here. So we're going to have a cluster size of 3 with a min size of 2. Now, for the purpose of demonstration, I'm just going to reduce my number of placement groups to 96. Then we can click create. Let's now repeat the exact same thing, but for SSD. So we can say block SSD and go to the crush rule, set it to replicated SSD. And once again, just for demonstration, I'm going to reduce the number of placement groups. Now, for the purpose of high availability, we can go over to Ceph and create a new monitor and manager for each node. This is entirely up to you. The purpose of this is if one Ceph node dies, for example, PVE1, Ceph will still be able to provide storage solutions for our virtual machines. So it's up to you whether or not you need the high availability. One of the other things with Ceph we can do is we can create a Ceph file system. So if we go to create here, and I can specify my main host here for a metadata server, and press create. For high availability, I can replicate this out once again to 3 servers. For a really reliable Ceph server, really I should have 5 nodes. However, 3 is good enough in my opinion for learning. Then we can create a new Ceph FS. I'm going to create 2 FSs. So one I'm going to call FSHDD, and just for examples, I'm going to reduce the placement groups. Now that's set up, I'm going to do the exact same thing for FSSSD. Awesome, that's set up now too. So let's go over to our pool configuration and let's change this because it's not got our custom crush map rule. So for FSHDD, I would like to give it my crush rule. Same for the metadata. And we're going to repeat the same exercise for SSD with its own crush rule as well, the SSD crush rule. Now, I've mostly done this for demonstration purposes, but we have all of these different pools available. Block hard drive and block SSD are if you want to mount a block drive into your virtual machine. So if you want to just have what seems to be a complete raw drive mounted into your virtual machine, this is usually unformatted and unusable directly. However, an FS mounted drive is literally, you could imagine it like a network attached drive. So it's literally already a formatted file system. And that's the difference between block and FS. So for example, when I'm going to create a new virtual machine, you can see my various block drives here. And I can always add extra drives if I want to. So for example, I could load in 2 block drives just like this. However, for the file system drive, I can do something a bit differently. So, for example, if I am inside of my live image here on virtual machine 1, I can start SSH so I can demonstrate things without having to worry about VNC again. By default, in these live USB disks, they try to discourage you from using SSH. So we have to go into our SSH configuration here and allow root login. And permit empty passwords to true, because by default, live USB disks tend to be passwordless. Now let's restart SSH with these changes. So now what I can do, if I go to my node here, I can SSH into my live user like this. But let's actually just SSH directly into root. Awesome. So From my host, I have now SSH'd into this virtual machine. It's going to make it a lot easier for me to actually work rather than using VNC. So now I can connect, let's come back out and let's generate my connection information for Seth. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to generate the minimal required configuration to connect to Seth. And now let's copy that into our virtual machine. I'm saving it into the Seth configuration file. Awesome. Now we need to create a key ring in order to authenticate. So I'm authorizing this Ceph's device, this FS underscore hard drive, and I'm creating the authentication keyring. Once again, we need to now copy this into our machine. So awesome, now we've copied that over. We can now go back into the virtual machine and try this out. First things first, let's give these new files the proper permissions. Just like that. Now let's make our new directory to mount to. Now, we want to make sure we know the IP addresses that our monitors are on, and we want to put this into our next command in order to mount Ceph, just like this. I should note I forgot to install Ceph Common first. This won't work unless you install Ceph Common first. Awesome, so we've been successful. We've mounted to mount FS hard drive, and we can see our mount here. It's not very interesting right now, but if we go into it, we can make a test file to see if it actually takes this. So I'm going to create a 1 gigabyte file. I'm doing it in increments of 64 megabytes because remember I made very small machines without a lot of RAM. So let's see if we can create a file and see if we go to Proxmox that it says that this data has been added. And if I go to my node and look at my volume here, I can see the metrics and see that it has exactly 1 gigabyte used of 15 terabytes. So we've successfully written this to Ceph. Anyway, I hope this video was really interesting and that you learned a lot of valuable information. If you have any questions or run into any issues, please mention them down in the comments because I would be happy to help you. As always, I hope you guys have a lovely day. Cheers.